So this is chapter 11, the childhood pastimes of Krishna. And Vrindavan is a most astonishing and wonderful place, because Krishna is present there. Although he is God, people don't think, Vrajvasis don't think of him as God. So here the Vrajvasis are saying, just before this, Putana has come, Shaktasur has come, who else had come? Trinavart has come. And just recently, in the previous chapter was a huge Nalaku, the trees fell down, but nothing happened to Krishna. So if you see some of Krishna's pastimes, the first three demons, they come either in the house or near the house. So Putana, she came right inside the house. Trinavart, just at the outskirts of the house, in the front yard of the house. Shaktasura was also in the front yard, the cart was there. Now later on we will see Krishna will start going out to the forest, and all the future demons are in the forest. Bakasur, Aghasur, Dhenukasur, then we have Keshi, all of them are outside. So as Krishna grows, he starts going out, and the demons also attack him when he's outside. So here the Vrajvasis are thinking Krishna is such a small child, and they are thinking how amid so many dangers Krishna has always been protected. So how did this happen? And they are saying this is the Lord's mercy. The Vrajvasis, they think of Krishna to be just one among them, just a very beautiful, lovable cowherd boy. Is the best among them, but he's just a coward boy. And that's why Yashoda Maya also thinks that I have to protect Krishna. If I don't feed Krishna milk, he will starve, he will become weak, he may even die. And such thoughts in her actually increase her devotion for Krishna. And when the Vrajavasis see here that those who came to cause the death of Krishna, they themselves died. But when they say this, how did this happen? It's a source of great wonder for them. First of all, in the life of a small child, great dangers coming is itself unusual. Somebody who is maybe pursuing a dangerous profession or something like that, many dangers come in their lives. In the lives of ordinary people, dangers only come occasionally. But one after another, dangers are coming. That itself is unusual, alarmingly unusual. And then so many dangers, they are just, nothing is happening to Krishna, but rather the dangers are getting destroyed. So that means, increase?
Yeah, increase.
Okay.
Picture
increase the volume. Not audible behind, is it audible now? There's a hiss that is coming, okay. Is it better now? Okay. So, they are wondering how is it this is happening? So they are thinking, something, maybe turn the angle
just
a little
turn
bit.
It, turn it
turn.
Away
from no, the other side.
The other side. Yes.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Okay. Now is it better?
Yeah.
Okay, let's see. So when Krishna comes to this world, oh God, is it remote? It's charged. Okay. What if I speak without it? Hare Krishna. If I speak without this, is it audible or difficult?
वंदे महापुरुषते चरणारविंदम्।
Vande Mahapurushate Charanaravindam. Vande Mahapurushate Charanaravindam. Vande Mahapurushate Charanaravindam. Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare. Hare Rama, Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare Hare. That's good. Okay. Thank you. So, the Vrajavasis, they don't know that Krishna is God. Or more precisely, it's not in the forefront of their awareness. It's like right now, it's daytime, but the stars are still there in the sky. However, we can't see the stars because the sun is so bright. So similarly, there is the madhurya, there is the love of the Vrajavasis for Krishna, and there is the knowledge that Krishna is God. So the love is like the sun, and the knowledge that Krishna is God is like a star in the sky. So it's there, but they're not conscious of it. And this is, this is Yoga Maya. Yoga Maya means this is a divine illusion. Vrajavasis don't consider Krishna to be God. Now we miss, I was once giving a class in India, and one person after class says, I also don't consider Krishna to be God. Now, that is very different. That is somebody who is in Mahamaya. So where to not know about Krishna, not accept Krishna's position as God, and to not even love him, that is to be an illusion. Maya means what? Illusion. Maya means illusion, that which is not. But Yoga Maya is a very special category of illusion. What does the word yoga mean?
Connection.
Connection with whom? Krishna. Yes, the ultimate reality. So it's a Yoga Maya means the illusion that increases connection. The illusion that increases devotion. Normally, illusion decreases our devotion.
Yes.
When we get caught in illusion, we get captivated by worldly things and we forget Krishna. But this is the illusion that increases devotion. So it is very anukool to bhakti. And so Yoga Maya is what in English called as an oxymoron. Is any of you studying for GRE or something, any of you know this word, oxymoron? What is that? Yeah, words that are contradictory. So if somebody says, that was brilliantly stupid. Is it brilliant or is it stupid? How can something be brilliantly stupid? So, or you might say, that was an outstandingly poor performance. Outstanding is very good, poor is bad. So outstandingly poor. So like that, when two opposite words are brought together, that is called as oxymoron. So Yoga Maya is like that. Yoga means connection, Maya means illusion. But when two opposite works are brought together, actually it is not just a fun play of words. It can have a deeper meaning. When he said that was brilliantly foolish, what that means is that okay, there are ordinary people who might do foolish things, but some people, they are intelligent, but they use their intelligence for a foolish purpose. That is brilliantly foolish. So, I was just talking to a youth yesterday evening. So, I was in IIT in India, and there's a problem. Many young people are committing suicide. So, they all committed suicide by hanging themselves from the fan. So, the IIT management had an emergency meeting, and they immediately passed unanimously a multi-lakh proposal to counter suicide. Yes? Replace all fans with air conditioners. So now that is the example of brilliantly foolish. So anyway, the point is, when we talk about divine illusion, Yoga Maya, the idea is that whatever increases our remembrance of Krishna, that is wonderful. And in the spiritual world, for the devotees, if they think that Krishna is God, Krishna is supreme, then they can't actually love him that much. He's God, I have to always respect him. But if they understand, oh, Krishna is just like a lovable child among us, their love for him increases. So yoga maya is that illusion which increases devotion. And this particular verse, that they are thinking that Krishna has been protected because of the mercy of the Lord. Well, Krishna is the Lord. But they are thinking Narayan is the Lord, and Narayan is up there, and Narayan has been very merciful to our child, and that's why he has been protected. So this is an example of yoga maya. So any questions till now? I'll take this class in three parts. After each part, you can have some questions if anyone has. So the first part was that basically the Vrijavasis are exhibiting how they are in yoga maya, intensely concerned about Krishna, but at the same time not aware that Krishna is, not consciously aware that Krishna is God. Any questions or comments?
Nand Maharaj is known that Krishna is Lord Vishnu. Like,
okay. Yes, does Nand Maharaj know that Krishna is Vishnu? It's a dicey thing, because what happens? He thinks he's our own, he's my son. And he has, when Gargamuni comes, Gargacharya, he also has a difficult task. On one side he's a Brahmana, so Brahmana is not meant to speak untruth. But at the same time, Krishna's safety is a matter of concern. Kamsa is out to persecute him. So, Gargamuni speaks in a very ambivalent way. He says that your child previously was the child of Vasudeva. So now, when Nandamaj hears this, he thinks previously means? A previous life, but actually it is this life itself. Earlier he was a child of, actually he is born, by birth he is a child of Vasudev, but now Nanda is taking care of him. So he says he previously was a child of Vasudev, and then he says that, he also says that Shukla Raktastha Pitas, he talks about that famous verse, he has appeared in another complexion. Which four complexions, does anyone remember? Golden complexion, green complexion, Krishna is in blue complexion, and then there is the white complexion, Shweta. So he says previously has come in these complexions also, and then he doesn't say your son is Narayan. He says your son is like Narayan. So like Narayan, like say when a couple is getting married, people may bless them and say you are like Lakshmi Narayan, you are like Sita Ram, there's blessing like that, that may you all be together happily. So now when he speaks it like that, what happens is, he thinks that my son is like Narayan, not that he is Narayan. And because he is like Narayan, later on in the Govardhan Leela, or after the Govardhan Leela, the Vrajivasis come and ask, how can Krishna, a small child, lift up a big hill for such a long time? And then he gives the expression, actually Gargacharya told me that he is like Narayan. So even after seeing him lift the hill, they don't think that he is Narayan. They think he is like Narayan. So Nanda Maharaj, actually till the end, he never accepts that Krishna is the son of Vasudeva. He thinks Krishna is my son. And that's why he feels very hurt when Krishna stays in Mathura. But he thinks that he is my child, and as Nanda Maharaj says, Gopal Champu describes that, oh, based on the prediction that Devaki's son will kill Kamsa. Now that I have killed Kamsa, Krishna comes and tells Nanda Maharaj that now they are saying that I am their son. But Krishna doesn't say I am their son. He says they are saying that I am their son. So then Nanda Maharaj starts laughing. Not laughing happily, laughing sadly. He says, it is our fortune that which is ours, great people are claiming it to be theirs. And he says, he accepts it. And he's very sad, but he accepts it at that time. So Nanda Maharaj never consciously is aware that Krishna is Narayan, or even that Krishna is the son of Vasudeva. He thinks Krishna is our Prajaraj. Okay, thank you. Any other questions?
So that mutra is because of their love to Krishna or because of Yogamaya?
Yes, both. Yogamaya facilitates their love for Krishna. The whole purpose of Yogamaya is to intensify their love for Krishna. So because they have so much love for Krishna, Yogamaya arranges that reality be adjusted in such a way that that love can be intensified more and more. Okay? Yes?
So Prabhu, the Vrajvasi is never realized till the end that Krishna is God?
Okay. the Vrajvasi never realized that Krishna is God? I wouldn't use the word realize, because realization is something which we get on our spiritual journey. But we, realization means that which is a reality, we accept it as a reality. That is a realization. So the Vrajavasis, they are already fully realized. They are already pure and exalted devotees. If you see the Gopi Gita, there at one of the most famous verses is the gopis are saying, Nalina Sundaram Nathate Padam Shila Trunankurai Siddhati Tina Kalila Tamana Kanta Gachati. See Krishna, when we think that you go out to the forest and you, your tender feet which are like lotus, Nalina Sundaram, they are pierced by the Shila Trunankurai, by the pebbles, by the thorns, by the wilderness of Vrindavan, our heart is ripped apart thinking that your feet are being scratched. So here they love Krishna so much that they are thinking even his feet should not get hurt. But in that same Gopi Gita they are also saying, Trunacharanugam Panifanarpitam Te Padambujam Krunaku Cheshuna Krundiruchayam. They are saying, Krishna, these lotus feet you offered to the serpent Kaliya. Fani Fanar Pitam. Now that means they know that Krishna subdued Kaliya. And Kaliya was an extremely dangerous snake. So that means they know the power of Krishna. And there are many places where they also say that you are actually Akhila Dehi Naam Antaratma Druk, that you are the indwelling super soul of all living beings. That means they know that Krishna is God. So you cannot say they never realize it. They know it, but it is just that is not in the forefront of their awareness. They know it temporarily, but then it goes in the background. Oh, Krishna is our lovable Vrajavasi. Okay, thank you. So we'll move on to the second point. Now, for us, we appreciate the divine illusion, the yoga maya of the Vrajavasis. And for us, to become attracted to Krishna, there are two aspects. There is Krishna's greatness and there is Krishna's sweetness. So, understanding Krishna's greatness creates submission. And understanding Krishna's sweetness creates affection. And the combination of submission and affection leads to devotion. Submission, no, Krishna is God, I should submit to him. That is submission. So understanding Krishna's greatness creates submission. And the Bhagavad Gita is all about Krishna's greatness, prominently. Krishna is supreme, Krishna is all powerful, Krishna is great. So when we study the philosophy, it's important by which, thank you.
Grace Chaitanya Charan Prabhu ki.
So understanding his greatness creates submission, and understanding his sweetness creates affection. So if we understand only his greatness and not sweetness, and Prabhupada says that it's like the sky is so great, but how can you love the sky? You can be, oh, sky is so great, but personal relationship and personal affection cannot be there. If you understand only his sweetness, not his greatness, then we start treating Krishna like an ordinary child, like an ordinary person, a nice entertainment character. So also Krishna is not just an object of entertainment, he is the objective of enlightenment. When we become enlightened, then we become devoted to Krishna. So understanding Krishna's greatness helps us to become enlightened. And understanding Krishna's sweetness enables us to become enlivened with devotion. So both are required. And the way to both is primarily through associating with those who have bhakti. The key how to increase our attraction to Krishna is to associate with those who are attracted to Krishna. And the great Vaishnavas, the great devotees have very beautifully glorified Krishna, and through their glorification of Krishna, we start feeling a sense of devotion for him. So in the 11th canto, there is a beautiful verse which describes the Lord's activities. Tyaktva sudustyajya surepsita rajya lakshmim dharmishta arya vachasaya dagadaranyam maya mrugam daita epsita manvadhavad vande mahapurushate charanarvindam. So this verse says, tyaktva, giving up, sudustyajya, that which is very difficult to give up. Tyaktva sudustyajya surepsita rajya lakshmim surepsita, that which was sought by even the devatas. Rajya lakshmim, that is a great goddess of fortune. So that wealth, that opulence, which is the manifestation of the goddess of fortune, which was sought by even the devatas, that Lord gave it up. Tyaktva sudustyajya surepsita rajya lakshmim dharmishta arya vachasa yadagadaranyam. Because he was dharmishta, he was following dharma, and arya vachasa, he wanted to honor the word of arya. Yet agadaranyam, he went to a forest. And then maya mrugam daita epsita manvadhavad, maya mrugam, that there was an illusory deer. And maya mrugam daita, considering that very deer, ipsitam, desiring that, anvadhavad, he ran after that. Vandehi mahapurushate charanarvindam, I offer my obeisances to that Supreme Lord. So who is this referring to?
Lord Ram,
yes. He's referring to Lord Ram, that he was born in Ayodhya. He was born in Ayodhya, but Arya Vachasa, because of the word of Arya. Who is that Arya? Whose word did he want to honor? Dashrath Maharaj. So Aga, the Aranyam, he went to the forest. And then the Maricha had come as the illusory deer. And he ran after that. Now Vishwanath Thakur explains that this same verse also refers to Krishna and also refers to Lord Chaitanya. Let's see how he does that. So he says, how is it referred to Krishna? This Tyaktva sudustyajya surepsita rajya lakshmim. He said he left the opulence. So Krishna was born in opulence. Where was he born? Mathura. So even at that time, we will see Mathura is like a city, Vrindavan is like a village. So the urban-rural division was always there throughout history. Now he came to, and then why did he go there? Dharmishta Arya Vachasa Yadaga Dharanyam. So he says, actually, it was Vasudev who brought him there. Vasudev was Dharmishta. He had promised Kamsa that whoever children are born, I'll give them to you. And Arya Vachasa is, his word was very honorable. So then, what did he do? If my child is born, I have to give him to Kamsa. But more important than honoring our word is honoring our Lord. Honoring our word is extremely important. But there is no value that is more important than devotion. All other values are meant to help us assist in devotion. And that was actually, can you come ahead a little bit, please? So, that was actually the blunder of Karna. Karna considered honoring his word more important than living an honorable life devoted to dharma. So honoring our word is important, but honoring our Lord is even more important. So adharmishta arevachasa, how was Vasudev dharmishta arevachasa? Because he considered that the purpose of all dharma is to worship Krishna, and that Krishna is here now. It is my service to protect him. Therefore, although he had given a word that I'll give my child to you, but he considered his service more important. And he did give a child, but that was a child which is brought from Yashoda's place. Yadagad, Aranyam, but because of Kamsa's persecution, he went to the forest, which was the Vrindavan forest. And now here it's interesting what Vishwajit Thakur says that Maya Mrugam Daitaya Ipsitam Anvadhava. He says that actually what happened in that forest of Vrindavan, Krishna became like a deer, a Mruga in the hands of Radharani. And whatever Radharani would tell him to do, Krishna would do that. And Krishna would run after Radharani. Now this is most famously depicted in Man Mandir. Have any of you been to Man Mandir in Vrindavan? Yes, Man Mandir is a beautiful place where what happens? Radharani is upset with Krishna. And in Krishna, in order to beg forgiveness, actually touches his head to the feet of Radharani. And God, everybody touches their head to God's feet, but God touches his head to Radharani's feet. And the names Radhika and Radha, a small difference between them. What is the difference?
In Krishna serves Radharani, she becomes Radhika.
Yes. So one who worships Radha and one who worships Krishna and one whom Krishna worships. So actually, this is Maya Murgam Daitaya Psitaman Vadhavad. So Krishna ran after Radharani in trying to please her, trying to pacify her. And that is Vande Mahapurushate Charanaravindam. Such is this great Lord. And not only that, he also says this verse also refers to Lord Chaitanya Mahaprabhu. Now how is that? He says that Tektva Sudustyajya Surepsitaraja Lakshmim. So first verse is talking about renunciation. So Lord Chaitanya Mahaprabhu was living in, where was he living? Navadvip Mayapur. Now, Navadvip was an opulent place. I say opulence is perceived differently by different people. If somebody is very interested in money, then they will see opulence in terms of wealth. Oh, this is such a wealthy place, I am living in such a wealthy community. But say somebody is very interested in learning. So somebody is a very studious person, they love studies and they love to research, understand. And for such a person, if they are able to go to some place like say Oxford, Cambridge, Harvard, where there is a rich atmosphere of learning, then that will be opulence for them. For a devotee just wants to love Krishna. So if there is abundant association of devotees who are devoted to Krishna, that will be opulence for that devotee. So opulence is perceived in different ways by different people. So Chaitanya Mahaprabhu was born in a Brahmin family, and in that Brahmin family, learning was valued. And at that time, Navadvip Mayapur was the headquarters of learning. And therefore, he was in a tremendously opulent place. But he gave up that opulent place. That was Chaitanya Mahaprabhu took sannyas. And then what did he do? Tyaktva sudustyajya surepsita lajya lakshmim dharmishta arya vachasa yadaga daranyam. Dharmishta arya vachasa. Because he was honoring dharma and he had to follow the word of a brahmana. Which was the word of a brahmana? Can you guess? Sarvabhattacharya, yes. There was a brahmana who was not allowed to enter into Lord Chaitanya Mahaprabhu's kirtans because he did not have much devotion. And there were kirtans happening at night, and when they were not allowed to enter, when he got very upset, he said, I am a brahmana, how can you not allow me to enter? You have offended a brahmana and I curse you. He said, I curse you that you will never be able to enjoy any happiness in family life. But Chaitanya Mahaprabhu took that curse as a blessing. He said, yes, to honor his word, I will renounce my family. Arya vachasa yadaga aranyam. Where did he go? To which aranya was that? Which forest did Chaitanya Mahaprabhu go to? Yes, he went to Vrindavan. True. That's much later. First he came to Puri, then he travelled across South India, then he went to North India, and North India he went to Vrindavan. So Vishwanath Chakravarti says that that forest which Chaitanya Mahaprabhu went to is the forest of material existence. All of us are in the forest of material existence. And he came, he was in this completely pious and devoted place. But he came to this, came to the place where people are not so devoted. And what did he do over there? Maya Mrugam Daitaya Ipsitaman Vadhavad. So here he says that actually all the souls, all of us, are like Maya Mruga. We are like the deer who are caught in illusion and are chasing after a mirage. So we are all chasing after worldly pleasure. And Maya Mrugam Daitaya. He considered these souls very dear to him. So the souls are running after illusion, and Chaitanya Mahaprabhu is running after them faster to catch them and give them Krishna's mercy. Srila Prabhupada was like that. Prabhupada is known as Jet Age Parivrajakacharya. Just traveled across the world. So, just traveled tirelessly. So, his own Jai Pataka Maharaj is also, you know, he travels despite his health and travels so much to chase after the souls who are caught in illusion and give them the illumination of Krishna Bhakti. So, Vande Mahapurushate Charanaravindam. I offer my obeisances to that great Lord. So in this way, there is one verse. But the great devotees are so rich with devotion that they can take out so many different meanings from one verse. Once there is love for someone, we can connect everything with the object of love. And when we see this profound love that the devotees have for Krishna, that's when seeing that attracts our heart. Seeing that enriches us with devotion. Similarly, when Krishna is playing as a small child, there's a famous Vaishnava Acharya who explains that as Krishna is just learning to walk, learning to move about, so he's crawling on the ground. When he's crawling on the ground, he moves his hand up forward and he moves on his knees. They've all seen children crawling. So he says, when Krishna is touching his hand to the earth, as he's walking on, what is he doing? He says, an ordinary person will think that he's just a small child crawling. But by touching his hand like that to the earth, he's actually pacifying Bhumi Devi. Since Bhumi Devi is distressed, Mother Earth is distressed because there are so many demons over here. And Bhara Utarna Yanye Bhuvona Vivodadao, that to remove the burden of the earth, remove the burden of the earth, Krishna is going to descend. But Krishna has not yet removed that burden. So just like if a child is sick and then a doctor comes along and the child is in pain, the doctor says, everything will be alright. Pats him on the back. To encourage him. Things are not yet solved, problem is not yet solved, but it will soon be solved. So like that, Krishna as a small child has not yet killed all the demons. He has not freed the earth from the persecution of the demons. But he is saying, yes, I will pacify, don't worry. So such is the sweetness with which devotees see even Krishna's ordinary actions. Every single action of Krishna can have multiple levels of meanings. And it is through the devotee's eyes, through the Vaishnava Acharya's eyes when we see, then we can start perceiving and relishing the attractiveness of Krishna. So this is how the Vaishnava Acharyas, they dive deep into the ocean of Krishna Leela and they bring out nectar. And they offer it to us. And when we get that nectar, when we drink that nectar, we become enriched, energized, enlivened with devotion. So any question at this point? Okay. So I'll make a last point and then we can conclude. So now, when we practice bhakti, we sometimes feel that I have devotion for Krishna. And sometimes we feel I have no devotion for Krishna. Sometimes, say when we are chanting, on a few days when our chanting goes very nicely, we feel as if chanting should never end. We feel such strength, we feel such power, we feel such purity coming from chanting. So chanting should never end. But most days we feel chanting never ends. Sometimes we are chanting in our bead, when you pick out the beads, see, you know, is this bead 108 or 1008? It appears as the round is just going on and on. So what happens for us, our mind is very fickle. And sometimes the mind feels attracted to Krishna, sometimes the mind doesn't feel attracted to Krishna. So we as souls are here, the mind is here, the world is here. And Krishna is also here. Of course, Krishna is right close to us, but our experience of Krishna is mediated through the mind. we perceive, even we come in front of the deities, sometimes we feel a lot of devotion. Sometimes we feel, okay, I had darshan, let me do next thing now. So we not feel any devotion. Because what happens, our mind comes in the way between us and the world. And the mind comes between us and Krishna also. The mind makes the world appear more attractive than it is. And the mind makes Krishna appear less attractive than he is. So that means that the mind, if we see a particular object, oh, I want to enjoy it. The mind makes it appear much more attractive than what it is. And although Krishna is supremely attractive, the mind makes him appear less attractive. Okay, Krishna Bhakti, okay, I'll do it sometime. Our tendency is just Krishna is good, but Maya is also not bad. So, in that way, we stay caught, sometimes this way, sometimes that way. So for us, if we want to increase our attraction towards Krishna, the process of bhakti is there. The acharyas, the Vaishnavas, they are there, they are speaking about Krishna, they are sharing about Krishna. But if our mind comes in the way, then the Krishna is here, Krishna's devotees are here, they are giving us Krishna. But the mind will come in between the way and the mind will not allow us to connect with Krishna or experience Krishna. And that's why we may feel as if, am I growing in my bhakti? And what this bhakti is just simply becoming like a ritual. So at such times, we can do two main things. When we just don't feel devotional at all, when we feel as if, why am I doing this? So at such times, the first thing we can do is that use our intelligence to understand that the mind's emotions are temporary. The mind's emotions are like weather. Sometimes the weather is hot, sometimes the weather is cold. And what happens with the mind's emotions? This is a very important point. Treating it like a weather means we don't try to change it. When it's hot, what can we do? If it's hot, it's hot. If it's cold, it's cold. We can't change it ourselves. So if we keep fighting with ourselves, I should not feel like this. It's a losing battle. Feelings will come on their own. Sometimes we'll feel devotion, sometimes we'll not feel devotion. Instead of trying to control how we feel, we can try to control what we do. We say, isn't it how, we may say, but isn't it how I feel going to determine what I do? That is the key point of self-control. That self-control is not necessarily controlling how we feel. See, yes, we would like to have always pure devotional feelings always. But they may come, they may not come. And as long as we are trying to fight controlling how we feel, it'll just be a frustrating battle. But instead of control, try to take control of what we do. So even if I don't feel devotion for Krishna, still I will chant His holy names. So when the altar opens in the temple and Krishna's darshan comes, we all offer pranams, we all offer obeisances to Krishna. So actually the acharyas, when the great saintly devotees, they see Krishna, they feel so delighted that they fall down and faint in ecstasy. Like Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, when he saw Jagannath for the first time, he ran and he fainted. Now in our case, we don't faint, but acharyas say at least fall down. At least bow down. You may not faint, but you fall down. So what happens? Just like fainting is not in our control. But of bowing down and offering obeisances is in our control. So if we try to control what we feel or how we feel, that is like trying to control the weather. Yes, we can't control the weather, but still we can control what we do. Okay, it's hot, but I have to go out for work. So still I'll go. I'll try to have ventilation in my car. I'll try to get there as quickly as possible so that I'll have ventilation. We'll try to adjust our actions. But so trying to control the weather is a losing battle. Trying to control our actions is much more doable. So similarly, when we just focus on doing what we can in that situation, gradually by that, the connection with Krishna will be established. And as even by our actions, we can connect with Krishna. Just we chant the holy names, we do some kirtan, we hear some katha, just start doing it. By that, the connection with Krishna is established. And once the connection with Krishna is established, then by that connection, all the distracting emotion that is there, all the rajas and tamas, the lower mode that are there, they start getting dissipated. They start getting dissipated. So, the first point I said is, don't try to control how you feel, try to control what you do. And second point in this is that we can try to find out something that also feels good within bhakti. So if this is a circle of things which I like, and this is a circle of things which are devotional things. So it's not that these two are non-intersecting. They can intersect somewhere. So find out where the two intersect. And then we do that activity more. Or we do that activity especially when we don't feel devotional. Say some devotees may just like kirtans. Just hear some kirtan, sing some kirtan. Some devotees may just love to take darshan of the deities. And especially not just any deities, but a particular deity. And not just a particular deity, but maybe a particular darshan of a deity. This deity looks so beautiful. I want to take darshan. So for some of us, it might just be shlokas. So we just love to recite shlokas. And not just shlokas, but not just any shloka, but some particular shlokas. And not just particular shlokas, but maybe in a particular meter. So Rupa Goswami in the Ujjwal Neelamani calls this Uddipan. Uddipan is spiritual stimulus. So just like all of us may have some material stimuli. So somebody who is a cricket fan, as soon as some cricket news comes up, they become very excited. What happened about cricket? Now somebody in a place like America, they think cricket means an insect. They don't even know cricket is actually one. Cricket is a sport is not known. For them, cricket news will not agitate much. But for somebody who is an Indian, is a cricket fan, cricket news will start exciting them. So just like in the material world, there are certain stimuli which excite us and certain stimuli that don't excite us. So similarly, in spiritual life also, yes, everything is connected with Krishna. There are many things connected with Krishna, but not everything will stimulate us. So we find out what stimulates us and then keep that accessible. Keep that readily accessible. If you like, if it's a particular kirtan, then keep that kirtan in your phone and just hear it regularly. You like a particular verse, keep that with you. And this stimulus will vary from person to person. So once I gave a class and I talked about how when we take darshan of the Lord, we can recite some verses and pray to Him. So for me, I am a very verbal person. So if I recite some verses, speak something, verbalize my emotions, then I feel the emotions. So then whenever I recite a verse, then I feel a connection with the Lord. This is the Lord who is being described by these words, that is the Lord who is present over here. So I gave a class and I spoke about how memorizing, reciting verses can help us feel the presence of the Lord, feel devotion. And after a couple of days, one devotee came to me and he said that, you know, after you told me, I've been trying when I take darshan to recite verses. He says, but you know, memorizing and recollecting and reciting verses causes me so much anxiety that whatever devotion I have, it goes away. So then I told him that I didn't say you should recite verses. I said that you find out what stimulus connects you. So for some people might be very visual. Just the sight of the Lord may attract them. Some people may be very musical. Yeah, when they hear some kirtan, then they start feeling some devotion. So, the shoe that fits one leg bites another leg. So similarly, with respect to Uddipan, we have to find the Uddipan that works for us. And when I say that, try to control what you do, not how you feel. So what you do means, at that time when we don't feel devotional, we connect with that Uddipan. We try to do what is the Uddipan for us. So just hear that kirtan which you like. Just take darshan of the Lord that you like. Recite the verses that we like. Or if we like to hear from a particular devotee, hear that devotee's classes. We may hear many devotees' classes, but if we feel inspired by a particular devotee, hear that. Or if we feel very inspired by a particular class, keep that class with you. Keep a video, audio clip of that. If it's not a full class, a part which inspires you. Just keep that ready. And then when we have the Uddipan ready, we will find that just by doing that, as the connection with Krishna will be established, then we will start feeling devotional again. And then we will be able to move forward steadily in bhakti. And as we move steadily in bhakti, as we become more and more purified, then the devotional emotions will become stronger and sweeter. And the non-devotional or the anti-devotional emotions will decrease. Will gradually go away. So that's how we can increase our attraction for Krishna. By committing ourselves to the steady practice of bhakti and by providing ourselves whatever resources are necessary for such practice. So I'll summarize. I spoke about how to increase our attraction for Krishna. And there I started by talking about how the Vrajavasis are in Yogamaya, divine illusion. Yogamaya is an oxymoron, that contradictory words which convey a higher meaning. So normally illusion decreases devotion, but the Vrajavasis illusion increases devotion. And then for us, we are not in Yogamaya. We are in the journey from Mahamaya, where we have forgotten Krishna, to Yogamaya, we want to go towards. So for us, devotion has two components. Hearing about Krishna's greatness creates submission. Hearing about Krishna's sweetness creates affection. And submission and affection together is genuine devotion. So for us, to develop that devotion, we need to hear from devotees. Hear from, associate with devotees. And especially when we see devotees relishing Krishna's pastimes, then we feel, oh, I also want to relish this. Not just Krishna's pastimes, even Krishna philosophy, Bhagavad Gita, whatever. So I talked about how Chakravarti Pad mines out three different meanings from one verse. At same Mande Mahapurushate Charanaranda verse, it can refer to Krishna, can refer to Ram, and can refer to Lord Chaitanya. And how the crawling of Krishna can also be seen as consoling by Krishna. And then last part I said is, when we are practicing bhakti, one is that we associate with devotees and from them we get devotion. But in the normal course of our life, we sometimes do not feel devotional at all. Because the mind comes between us and Krishna. And the mind makes the world seem more attractive than it is, and it makes Krishna seem less attractive than he is. So when the mind becomes filled with non-devotional or anti-devotional emotions, what can we do? We treat the emotions like the weather. Don't try to control how you feel, control what you do. So as soon as we start acting in a devotional way, even if you're not feeling devotional, just that action will connect us with Krishna. And gradually that connection will remove the non-devotional emotion. And for doing such action, we can find out what is the Uddipan for us. What is our particular spiritual stimulus? The thing that I like to do and the thing that is things that are bhakti, where do they intersect? And if we keep that Uddipan with us readily accessible, then that will be able to trigger spiritual emotion within us, and therefore we can again establish the connection with Krishna. And once that connection with Krishna is steadily established, then we will become purified and our devotion will become sweeter, stronger and deeper. Thank you very much. Hare Krishna. Sir. We'll come back to you. Yes, bro.
Two questions. One is, what is the name of the Brahmana who passed Chaitanya Mahaprabhu? And second is, you say Rajatya and Radha. If you could explain all that.
Well, the Brahmana, I don't think his name is mentioned in Chaitanya Charitamrita. And the name Radhika, it refers to one who worships Krishna. Radha refers to one who is worshipped by Krishna. So, actually in Sanskrit, the words can be interpreted in different ways. More important than the specific meaning of the word is the mood. The mood is that there is a reciprocal relationship between the divine couple, and they are that Krishna, Radharani worships Krishna, but Radharani is also worshipped by Krishna. And at different times it is different. Sometimes Radharani is searching for Krishna, like in Ras Leela when Krishna goes away. At that time, Radharani is searching for Krishna. But there are other times when Krishna goes away, Radharani is in man mood and Krishna searches after. So the point is that neither of them, it's not that that Krishna is God and Radharani is constantly serving him. That's the mood of service is always there, but the way in which that service is executed is different at different times. So that even God becomes controlled by his devotee, that's what is illustrated through the analysis of these words. Okay, thank you. Yes, no?
Devaki and Vasudev, they know that their son is Narayana because they,
yeah, correct.
Because Krishna appeared in the four angel form.
Yes, correct.
And then after they pray, they Krishna converted in, you know, into Shamshandarpa. And then Vasudev shifted Krishna to Vrindavan.
Correct.
So when after that, when they meet, Nanda Maharaj goes and meets Vasudev. Why Vasudev did not reveal this to
Okay, good question. So why does Vasudeva not reveal to Krishna, to Nanda Maharaj, that Krishna is my son? The same reason because of which he had first sent Krishna away. That is fear of Kamsa. When they meet for the first time, Kamsa is still in power. And that's, and Nanda Maharaj has come to Mathura to pay taxes. And then Vasudeva tells him, now you have paid taxes, we have met your, we have met, now you can please go back as soon as possible. Because now there might be some danger. So because the danger is still present, that's why he doesn't tell. Because Kamsa is still there in power. So what might happen is, it's a secret is best kept when it is kept with one person or two people. They said that people who can't keep secrets, tell others, I'll tell you and you keep the secret. So... So Vasudeva felt that, see, Nanda Maharaj is also, Vasudeva is a king, he's a diplomat. So he knows, speak this here, speak that there, not in the manipulative sense, but that's just required for functioning as a king. But Nanda Maharaj is a very simple person. So his simplicity is also sweet, but that kind of secret, he might not have been able to keep it. And at that point, telling it to Nanda Maharaj would not have served any purpose. If somebody has to take care of a child, they need to put their full effort in taking care of the child. So if at the back of their mind it is always that this is not my child, then maybe the affection may go down. It may not also, but it might. So what purpose would be served at that particular point by Vasudeva telling Nanda Maharaj? It might just decrease the love that Nanda Maharaj might be able to shower on them. Krishna, and it could increase the danger, but no constructive purpose would be served. The secrecy would be the best way to protect Krishna at that time. That's why I didn't tell. Okay. Thank you.
One more question.
Any other? I'll come back. Any other questions? Anyone has?
Hare Krishna.
Yeah, we'll come back. Okay.
All the variables are all in Mahabhava status.
More? Yes, definitely. No, wait a minute. Now, are all the Vrajavasis in the Mahabhava status? See, the words have different meanings in different contexts. So if you say Mahabhava as a technical word meaning a particular state of devotion, then that state Chaitanya Charan describes is with Radharani. And maybe Chaitanya Mahaprabhu also, but not with many other people. So but if you consider Mahabhava simply as generally a great devotion, then that is there with everyone. So words have technical meanings and general meanings. Say if a scientist is doing some experiment in a laboratory, and the scientist says is doing some electrical equipment testing, and he says we have run out of energy. I have no energy now. Yes, that means the battery has got discharge or whatever. Then the assistant will understand and will give the battery over there. But then the scientist comes back home and tells his spouse, I have no energy now. She will not bring a battery there. So there the word energy means something different. So words can have technical meanings and they can have general meanings. So Mahabhav in a technical sense, if Chaitanya Charitamrita if we use, then it's that very exalted devotion is with Radharani. But in a general sense of very great devotion, all Rajvasis have that. Okay, thank you. Yes, there is a question here.
We are getting this your lecture every day, Hira daily, spiritual scientist, and you are teaching alone. How do you manage the healthy life?
How?
I am not able to manage my sadhana in the healthy time, like the chanting. The time, it's not consistent. So how do you manage the time, which is
peacefully? Okay, how do we manage a sadhana in a healthy way? See, first thing is, it's important to understand the purpose of sadhana. Purpose of sadhana is to connect with Krishna. And it is best that we do our sadhana in the morning, because at the time we are less distracted. There's so many things to do that come up in the day. But the important thing is to connect with Krishna. So sometimes, if we arrange an overall schedule for ourselves, then we are able to do sadhana in the morning. And that is good. But life sometimes comes in the way, it's quite unpredictable. So, regulation is important, but attachment to regulation also is undesirable. There is a difference between the two. There is attachment to regulation is good, but attachment to regulation is not good. Our attachment should be to only Krishna. Sometimes what happens, for some devotees I have seen, they decide, I will do my sadhana, I will chant my japa before I take breakfast. And then they are not able to do it, and then they don't know whether I should take breakfast, or they do something. And then they feel so guilty that I could not do this. Mm-hmm. And then eventually when they are chanting the rounds, they are not remembering Krishna, they are remembering their guilt. Mm-hmm. So that is not really bhakti. I mean, bhakti is centered on remembering Krishna. We want to offer our best to Krishna, that is true. But surrender means to do the best with what we have now. So if we were in a better world, maybe every day we could do a sadhana in the mornings. But sometimes so many things come up. And what happens is, if we become too rigidly attached to regulation, then we become insensitive, we might become irresponsible about other things. Or we might become very resentful of other things. Why is this coming this way? Why is this coming this way? And then that resentment will interfere with our devotion also. So the important thing is that we stay connected with Krishna. And if we can do it in the morning, that is good. But if we can't do it in the morning, do it when we can. And try to do it in good consciousness. See, if we can't succeed in Krishna consciousness, we can still fail in Krishna consciousness. We don't have to fail out of Krishna consciousness. What do I mean by this? That Krishna consciousness is not just adherence to certain actions. Krishna consciousness is a consciousness, is a connection with Krishna. So somebody may decide, I want to fast Nirjal on Ekadashi. And they try their best, but they can't fast. Just feel too much tormented, feel burning in the stomach, they feel faint, like fainting, and they take some food. Now they may feel, oh, I failed in Krishna consciousness. But no. The important thing is to be Krishna conscious. Somebody might fast Nirjal and then they go to the kitchen and see who all are eating what all. Then their body may be fasting, but their ego is feasting. And they will not make much advancement by that. So on the other hand, somebody might not be able to fast. But if they think, okay, I couldn't fast Krishna, but I still serve you. Then you just take some food and then serve Krishna. So both extremes could be, say somebody fasts and thinks, say, just see I fasted. Well, they're not thinking about Krishna, they're thinking about their success in fasting. And somebody else, they couldn't fast and they're thinking, oh, I didn't fast. And they're also not thinking of Krishna. So that is not of much use. Bhakti requires austerity, but bhakti is not dependent on austerity. Bhakti can be practiced even by somebody who is not able to do much austerity. That's why we don't have to be very rigid about our sadhana. Certainly, we cannot be completely nonchalant. We have to have a schedule and we try to stick to the schedule. But if we can't, we understand that, okay, I can't do it this way, let me do it this way. So if we try to see that more than doing the sadhana is remembering, more important than doing the sadhana is remembering the purpose of sadhana. And the purpose of sadhana is to remember Krishna, is to connect with Krishna. Sometimes some devotees, they say, I want to complete my japa in the morning. And to complete a japa in the morning, they chant like a super fast speed. they're just going so fast, they're not pronouncing the words clearly, they're not concentrating. Now, of course, some devotees can speak fast and pronounce also, and remember also. I'm not saying you can't. But sometimes what happens, it becomes like, we complete our rounds in the morning, but how much have we remembered Krishna? So, most important thing is, that sadhana is meant to help us remember Krishna. And sometimes, if circumstantially something comes up, you know, say somebody falls sick at home, or some job emergency comes up, some family situation comes up, then we pay attention to that, we take care of it, and we see that also, we do it in the mood of service to Krishna. Now, if an emergency is coming every day, then it is not the situation that is the emergency, it is our own planning that is the emergency. Emergencies don't come every day. So, on an overall pattern, we need to have a schedule. But if occasionally, sometimes the schedule doesn't work, we don't have to be attached to it. We stay attached to Krishna and do the best that we can. Okay? So, shall we stop? So, thank you very much. Shri Prabhupada ki, Gaur Bhakta Vrinda ki, Gaur Premanande.
Jai.